Mainstream Mental Health Radio with Dr. John Huber.
What do you think you are, crazy or something? Well, you're not.
We're on a mission from God.
News, issues revolving around mental health.
Dr. John Huber, a mental health professional for over 20 years, the chairman for Mainstream Mental Health, a clinical forensic psychologist, and a psychology professor at Texas State University. Breaking the silence of mental health, one day at a time, discussing the human condition, providing a sounding board for mental health issues, and making mental health mainstream.
You got a gift, my friend.
Now it's time for Mainstream Mental Health Radio.
Let the healing begin.
With Dr. John Huber.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Mainstream Mental Health Radio Show. I'm your host, Dr. John Huber. And today we're going to talk about mental health, which is dear to my heart, but a special topic here dealing with foster care system, parents in foster care. And we have an amazing writer, Jeanette Yoffe, and she has been doing this her whole life, literally, and I'll let her explain in a minute. But she has some insights into this world that I've only been able to experience as a psychologist working with families and people, children in foster care. She is the executive director and founder of Celia Center, a support center that meets critical needs for all of these connected with by foster care and adoption. She is also the clinical director of Yoffe Therapy. So with that, I'd like to introduce Jeanette Yoffe. Jeanette.
Hi. Thank you for having me, John. This is great.
It's Jeanette or Janet. I'm messing that up already.
Jeanette.
Yes. All right, Jeanette.
Yes, Jeanette.
Jeanette
Yoffe.
Oscar. Yoffe. I did correct myself on that. Okay.
Yes. So, Thank you.
Well, so, you know, we kind of talked off the air, but what drove you into this area? Tell your story a little bit. You know, why are we talking today?
So I was raised in foster care. I was born in New York, and I was in foster care for 6.5 years. And then I was adopted at the age of 7.5. And I asked my mother, you know, what brought her to adoption, and they had infertility challenges, and they chose to adopt, and I have a few siblings, and we fostered some children. So having that life experience just really put that under my belt that I have this paraprofessional experience, and then I decided to move to Los Angeles and pursue theater. And I wrote a play called What's Your Name, Who's Your Daddy? About growing up in foster care and adoption. And it was actually healing and cathartic, and I was in therapy myself. And when I wrote and produced this play in Los Angeles, I didn't realize the impact of foster care in Los Angeles County, that there were over 30,000 children in foster care.
Wow.
And that, to me, just really... I thought, oh my gosh, I'm one of the lucky ones. I was adopted, and there are many children who will never be adopted and never have the opportunities that I had. So that's when I started volunteering at an adoption support center. And then I realized I knew more than the professionals did about the experience. And I said, I think I'm going to go back to school and get my master's in clinical psychology, which is what I did. And then I started seeing children in LA County, doing attachment work, working on all those pieces, helping kids make sense of their stories, helping them work on their grief. And I wrote a book called Groundbreaking Interventions, Working with Traumatized Children, Families, and Teens in Foster Care and Adoption, because I realized there wasn't enough mental health treatment focusing on this population and doing therapeutic interventions. Then I did that, and then I started one little support group once a month for 2 hours, and the first support group, 60 people showed up. And I was amazed. I said, wow, there really is a need here. And what I include is it's for anyone 18 and over who's connected by foster care and adoption. So that could be an adult adoptee, a foster youth alumni, foster parent, adoptive parent, those thinking about fostering and adopting, and birth parents, families of origin. So we all meet and support each other and figure out what is the best practice in foster care and adoption today, because what we've been doing isn't working. More and more kids are entering the system, and our topic today, there's many mental health challenges that are not being addressed or looked at, and we're just brushing it under the rug. And it really, I really appreciate you having this conversation today about this topic.
And it's true. I mean, you know, healthcare is in the spotlight, but mental health care seems to be in the shadows. And when they have to cut funding somewhere, it's mental health care because we don't speak up. And that's part of the reason why I started my organization, this podcast, is to get people to start talking about this. And my best friend was put up for adoption at birth. I have a family member who just recently put her child up for adoption. And, you know, I got to meet the adoption parents and all this kind of stuff. Beautiful family. And, you know, in retrospect, you know, it's a tough thing, but it was probably the best thing for the child. And, but there was so much going on. And, you know, being a psychologist, it's like, let's take care of business. Let's make sure this stuff, you know, that you're okay, that the parents are going to be okay, the adopting parents are going to be good. And we went through this process, and it was like, wow, people are actually doing this, you know, and yeah, we're wanting to make sure that these children have the best possible situation that we can give them, period. And, you know, it was kind of shocking that people were surprised we were going through all this and getting help for the birth mom, getting help for the adopted parents, et cetera, the kids and the family. So it's so, you know, we talk about mental health care not being supported. This is not being supported virtually at all compared to the rest of mental health. So it is a weak spot for sure.
Yes, it is. And I think it scares people because the challenges are overwhelming. The behavioral statistics and the mental health challenges are overwhelming. And it's like, where do you start? So I was just looking up some statistics that only 23% of children in foster care actually receive mental health services, which is very scary.
I believe it. I mean, I end up doing it because the courts get involved and they come knock on my door. Hey, come work with this kid because there's something going on there and we're prosecuting somebody and we want to make sure. But it's a little late. You know, they should have been doing it to start with.
Right. And here's where because I'm a psychotherapist and this is my specialty.
Yes.
We think children are resilient. Resiliency is lifelong. You can be resilient because there are certain factors of, you know, you had that one person who was with you creating a stability in your life, but some kids don't have that and they don't have
right.
that resilience factor. Most kids, and I say this and you can quote me, do need mental health therapy if they're in foster care. They may appear like everything's okay, but just because they're not actively talking about it does not mean they're not actively thinking about it.
I would take that a step further and say all kids need it, but especially today with our screen mentality, but foster care kids need it even more.
Exactly. So if I could just say that, you know, foster youth, you know, they will end up, some of them on an average stay in foster care for 2 years and maybe reunified with their birth families.
Okay.
Family of origin. Some kids experience 3 placements, some experience 20 placements. There are many different reasons why children enter foster care. Their exposure to violence, traumatic incidents, loss of a parent, abuse, neglect, families don't have support. You know, we're not supporting families also. It's like, what is the root cause of foster care? It's families not receiving support. And so there's a lot of back and forth, like, where does the support need to go? Families need support today. I mean, if we're really going to
families need support,
rethink foster care.
But look how welfare and stuff like that works. They get more support if mom and dad try to stay apart than if they try to stay together.
Right.
So then, you know, all these other things, communication is not there, and then it creates a hostile environment, and it just escalates.
It's challenging. And sometimes when families do enter the child welfare system, they actually can get the support they need and children can be reunified with their parents.
Absolutely.
Which is what foster care is. That's the goal of foster care. It's family reunification.
Yes.
But what happens is kids fall through the cracks. They're not receiving mental health services. And if I could just say there are basic human needs that we all need to feel secure and stable in the world, especially if something very scary and overwhelming happens to us. Our basic human need is we need food, water, and shelter. Okay, we need
yes.
our basic physical needs met. And that's what foster care does provide. But then foster care needs to take it a next step. Foster parents need to provide nurturing, supportive, loving environment. But here's the problem, is parents are not taught, educated in trauma-informed practice. Because now you have a child who experienced something extremely overwhelming, most likely traumatic. Not all kids are traumatized, but something happened to them that
right.
sent them into child welfare. And parents think that kids are resilient, or they'll get over it, but kids don't get over things. And it will take sometimes a lifelong processing of what happened to them in the first 5 years of their life, because the first 5 years of our lives, that's when all the brain is being structured and creating this blueprint for the rest of your life. So parents...
Well, I mean, look at the research on sociopaths. Yeah. It's that first few years in life that are pivotal that make that. Yeah, it's serious. It is significant.
Yes, it is. It is. So I teach a lot of trauma-informed practice. I teach that to Department of Mental Health here in LA County, mental health workers, social workers, and parents. Because there's many different pieces, and if I could go into what are the mental health issues, challenges that we're dealing with, is we have something stressful happened. So we have children diagnosed with anxiety disorders, diagnoses, you know, panic attacks. And if you break down any diagnosis, you can break it down to not being able to manage stress.
Right.
Okay, so it's just diagnoses are all just broken down into different criteria. So a lot of kids have anxiety disorders. That's one level. So when I usually start my trainings, it's let's just look at one of the core pieces for a child is they have to learn how to manage their stress. Then what happens? Then you have another layer. Now we also have to deal with the grief and the loss pertaining to what they were removed from and now placed in foster care. So they have depressive diagnoses, you know, major depression, bipolar, suicide ideation, because no one's acknowledging they have been removed everything they've ever known. So they're grieving. They're in mourning. That's another whole layer that gets overlooked, I do feel. In this field, we have kids who are grieving the loss of their schools, the loss of their friends, the loss of their cultures, the loss of their families, the loss of their neighborhoods. And I'm going to tell you what's surprising for parents. Most kids, no matter how traumatizing or scary their situation was before they went into child welfare, do want to go back.
Yep.
Because it's all that they know. It's their homeostasis. So
right.
then the other piece is we have attachment challenges because most likely there was attachment trauma. I mean, we're dealing with children. The caregivers did not provide a stable and secure environment. So we have children now also coming into the system, not with the stress, the grief, and now they have significant attachment challenges, which makes parenting these kids very hard for caregivers.
And I think you've identified something too. They get all these other diagnoses. They get anxiety. They get depression. When the true diagnosis really should be PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, because it encompasses all of that. And you start working with the individual as a whole unit, as opposed to let's just focus on your anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
and it's all. It's not one part of it. We got to go for the whole thing. Yeah.
Yeah, there's many layers, and I think it overwhelms caregivers, it overwhelms mental health workers, because all they see is the behaviors. And what we're learning in trauma is you have to look beyond the behavior, and you have to look at what's driving the behavior. So the trauma lens, if I can say, that is really important in the the world of working with children who have significant mental health challenges due to trauma, loss, and attachment is trauma lens. You have to look at them different. And because parents, a lot of foster parents have been parents before, and they have their own biological children, and they're like, oh, I parented before, I can parent another one. Well, this one you have to look at differently. They're not like your other kids. So you have to put on a different set of glasses. And the lens is, when they're behaving, you're not looking at them and going, what's wrong with you? You're looking at them and going, what happened to you that you're behaving in this way right here, right now? And one of the phrases I use a lot is, what's hysterical right now, we must assume, is historical. It has to have something unresolved to do with their past. And it's coming up for a good reason, because they're emotionally, in the moment, feeling a sense of, I'm ready to work on this, unconsciously. Whatever's coming up consciously is ready to be worked on. So parents need to put on these glasses, the trauma lens, and stop looking at what's wrong with this behavior to, this is exactly what needs to be happening right now, and this is exactly what I need to bring my attention to. That children are overwhelmed, scared, stressed out, not because they're trying to manipulate or want attention, because they need our attention. And then the other little piece about trauma lens is, if you look at them and also recognize, it's not that they won't behave like other kids their age. It's because they can't. And most kids with significant trauma have at least a 2-year emotional and psychological delay. So you may have a 12-year-old, but you really have a 10-year-old or even younger emotionally and psychologically. And that stresses parents out too, because they're like, wait, she's 13, but she really acts like a 3-year-old. And I said, well, you have to look at her emotionally and psychologically as a 3-year-old. Don't talk to her like a 3-year-old, but you're being mindful. As her parent, who's trauma-informed, she can't do things like other 12-year-olds.
Exactly. Well, and as a former school psychologist, I'm like, you know, I don't know how many times I got called in to address behavioral issues for some student who had issues like this. And I'm like, okay, you know, we have to address this student differently with respect, but we have to go about it a little different. And I would get so much grief and feedback from the teachers, the principals, the assistant principals, but it's a reality we have to deal with. You know, if these kids could act normal on their own volition, they would. They don't want to be the center of attention.
Right.
They've had enough of that.
Yeah, and they have a lot of shame. And
absolutely.
Shame is really hard to self-regulate for a child who
believes
everything is their fault. Because anything that they do, they make a mistake, they believe they're the mistake. They cannot differentiate themselves from their behavior, which makes parenting them even harder. And parents do need to do a different approach. And I always say, validate them first as a person, and then put the emphasis on their behavior separate from the person.
Absolutely. Well, so and nobody wants to be, nobody wants to be looked upon like something's wrong with you, or you're not smart enough, and you're acting like, you know, you said it right, developmentally you're a couple of years at best behind, if not more. So they know their behavior looks childish, and none of them want to look like a dumbass, so they would rather be a badass, and they just take that behavior and escalate it, because nobody there is compassionate. They don't have the insight, and it's not because we don't want to, it's we don't have the training, we don't have the information. And this is exactly what you're telling us. I think you're right.
Yeah, they're having a healthy response to an unhealthy internal threat, which is a memory or thought or sensation in their body related to whatever they may not be able to filter. But in the moment, when they see someone reaching up for a glass and they've been physically abused, they're gonna have a reaction. Am I about to be abused? That's their internal working model. So we have to show them otherwise and create an environment where we're understanding, like you said, compassionate about what happened to them. child. So
absolutely.
Here's what happens, why I think also we have this misunderstanding of the mental health issues is not only are foster parents not provided the adequate information of the child's history, social workers aren't provided the information because they either get it convoluted, the child enters the system, and then the parents go AWOL, which happens a lot. So birth, you know, the family of origin, the mother and father,
right.
They don't have any history. And this child, who knows, they just found them living homeless in their car. But we have no idea what happened 4 years prior.
Right.
You have a child coming into your home where you're like, okay, I know nothing about you. Like, I was 7 and a half, and my adoptive father said, when you came to us, he goes, you came to us, and I looked at you, and I said, wow, she has a whole history that I know nothing about. And I was a whole person. I was 7 and a half, and that dawned on me, too. You know, parents aren't given the information, and social workers, which makes their job harder. But something that I do, and I don't, you know, is for therapists and to provide for parents, is I have parents create a log. Just a log. It's a who, what, where, when, and how. So whenever you see those hysterical behaviors, just get a notebook, date it. Okay, we're at the park, and this man came over to the sandbox, and he was wearing a red shirt, tall man with a beard. Okay. And the child, she became clingy, overwhelmed, stressed out. Okay, so if we start seeing patterns, we can then be more curious and go, maybe something did happen. With someone who was a perpetrator or whatever, we know something. Like, I had a child, he was 12, he would not go into the shower. And we suspected, was there sexual abuse? Did something happen in the shower? Well, apparently, what we found out as he grew older and could talk about his story was once he was punished so badly, he went into the shower and smeared his feces all over the shower and refused to go back into the shower.
Wow.
One of the ways that he was punished was they would put him underwater, well, you know, put the shower on cold water, and that's the way they disciplined him, to get him to do what they wanted. Now, this was 10 years ago. I mean, if this happened today, we would hope that they would be removed, which he was, from that foster home. But it took us a while to figure out why. Not why won't he go in the shower, why can't he go in the shower? Well, we need to step back and go, what happened to him? And so we would sit outside the shower and just sit there and talk about, like, whoa, what's the big feeling we're having in front of the shower right now? But little by little, you can't just jump into it. You have to do dose by dose by dose. And it's a process, and there's a lot of patience that goes into this work. And we have a high turnover in the field of mental health, especially in child welfare. So we have health providers who are not committed, that, you know, are here just to get their hours. They want to go in private practice. They're not staying in the long haul, which is the stability that a lot of these kids need. And someone who knows their history, can track their history, can provide that information for the new caregivers.
Right.
And if the social worker is there, is a new social worker, she can then provide that information to the social worker. So it's complicated. There's a lot of challenges in that area. And again, the provider training is really, really important, because even if they receive their foster care certification, when you have a child in your house, it's a whole different story.
It's a whole different story.
And support.
And it takes a very special patient, understanding human being to do that, do it successfully. And it's same, you know, and that's the other thing. We have a high turnover in the mental health care workers. A lot of it is because they also had a different concept of what it was going to be like. And then they got involved and they saw how extremely difficult it is to work. And it's just overwhelming. And they weren't prepared to be in that field with those kids. So my question to you is, you know, how's your relationship with your adopting parents? How is that today?
Oh, I mean, fantastic.
Amazing. Exactly. And that's awesome. That's the way it should be.
Oh, yeah.
And I know you thank them every time you see them.
I mean, I was one of the, you know, my parents had a choice. They had, I was adopted through Jewish childcare. They presented them with a baby, which is, you know, what most families want because you can start from the beginning. And my mom kept thinking, what's going to happen to that 7.5-year-old girl? And she called them back and said, I want her. And I'm so grateful because I would not be sitting here talking with you and doing the work that I do and I get to do. Because for me, it's healing. And for me, when I get to just sit in front of another foster youth and go, we're going to get through this.
Awesome.
You and me. It's so powerful and I'm empowered. And I always tell parents, use more we, not more us when you're talking with your children. We're going to figure out this problem together. We're going to get through this together. We're a team so that because the attachment piece is so crucial. And even social workers and therapists, you know, we're going to work on this together. It's not me and don't separate because there's the stigma that they need to fix this all by themselves. But this population needs more we, hands-on, time-in parenting. And the attachment is so crucial.
Well, Jeanette, we are running short on time, so we need to try and wrap this up. Can we start with where can my listeners get a hold of you and find out more about you, maybe your books, that kind of thing? Where's a good place for them to do that?
Yes. So beyond becoming a therapist, I started Celia Center. So Celia, C-E-L-I-A, center.org. Which is the nonprofit organization that I started because I realized with the 30,000 children in foster care, we need more support for families. So I started a support group 10 years ago called Adopt Salon Support Group. It's still happening in Los Angeles. You can go to the website. It's the first Wednesday of the next one is in March. We also have special events. We have our next mental health conference, which I'd love to come back and talk to you about, November 13th, 2020. At the Lux Sunset Hotel.
Awesome.
Yep. So we are really instrumental in finding best practice here in Los Angeles to be a model for the country. There's many organizations across the country doing the same. And then I wrote my book, Groundbreaking Interventions, which is on Amazon. And then one last thing is, play that I wrote 20 years ago and performed. I just recorded it on Audible.
Awesome. Oh,
called,
great.
What's your name? Who's your daddy?
What's your name?
And
who's your daddy?
What's your name? Who's your daddy? And surprisingly, I've had parents call me and tell me they've listened to it with their child and they've learned something that, you know, things stuck out for
awesome.
Them, understanding all the levels. And then I've had social workers say they're going to present it at their support group. So
awesome.
It becomes another educational, psychoeducational piece, understanding the internal world of foster care and the foster youth and truly what they need, their best
awesome.
Mental health.
Now we've talked about a lot of things right now. What two things do you want to leave my listeners with, whether we covered them in our discussion or not? Give me two things that we need to remember as we wrap this up.
Two things, that there are core strengths of foster youth that get overlooked. And there are seven, but I'll go through them quick. They're brave, they're adaptable, they're observant, strong-minded, believe in goodness, are futuristic thinkers, and are determined to live a better life.
All right, seven. And the last...
I think if you want to help, you can volunteer at a foster care agency, become a CASA advocate and mentor. If there's anything that's so crucial, is having someone who sees them, knows them, and is able to receive them as a full, whole person. So that's mentoring, volunteering, or advocating for these kids.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much for spending time with us and coming out. And letting the world know your story more than what you've already done, because you've done a lot, and I'm impressed by that. Yeah. Thank you very much for all you've done. And with that, I'd like to remind everybody that life is what happens while you're making plans. So buckle up.
Mental Health on Facebook. Please tune in every week to Mainstream Mental Health Radio with your host, Dr. John Huber.